Welcome to the University of Rochester Pathology video series. Today we'll be covering the normal histology of spongy and compact bone. The current 10x image we're seeing right here shows the normal histology of spongy bone. We can tell this is spongy bone because of the presence of marrow and fat. Another key feature of spongy bone are these solid pink structures called trabeculae. This image is a representation of spongy bone. The solid part, or the part that we would actually consider bone, are the trabeculae, and in between the trabeculae, those little pores, are where bone marrow and fat cells are located. Taking a closer look at the trabeculae, we'll see that it sort of has a hardwood floor pattern to it, and this is made up of type 1 collagen fibers. When we zoom into a 20x image of the trabeculae, we'll notice bone cells called osteocytes that appear to be trapped in these little pockets called lacunae. This is the product of bone development as osteoblasts, a key cell in bone growth, become encased in calcium phosphate. Two more important bone cells to observe are osteoblasts and osteoclasts. These two cells tend to hang around the periphery of the trabeculae. Osteoclasts are large multinucleated cells that deal with bone reabsorption. Osteoblasts, like I said before, deal with bone development. This would make sense as to why both of these cells will like to hang around the edge of the trabeculae because they're constantly adding or removing layers of bone. So some key points to remember about spongy bone are that it's the only type of bone that will contain marrow and fat. Spongy bone will also have trabeculae, which are smooth with a hardwood floor pattern. Some cells that we can find in spongy bone are osteocytes, which are trapped in lacunae, and osteoblasts and osteoclasts, which tend to hang around the periphery of the trabeculae. So another important type of bone that we have is compact bone. The following images that I use are taken from the URMC digital slides, specifically slide 12, so feel free to copy and paste the link and follow along. Compact bone surrounds spongy bone, which provides the characteristic strength and rigidity. Looking at the current slide, we'll see that compact bone is made up of multiple haversian systems, or osteons. The center of each osteon consists of a haversian canal which contains blood vessels, lymph vessels, and nerves. This pretty much acts as the main source of nutrient for compact bone. We can also note the concentric layers surrounding the haversian canal, which are called lamellae. Like we saw with spongy bone, compact bone also have lacunae, which also happen to be the sites of mature osteocytes. We can also note these long channels running through the lamellae called canaliculi. These channels connect lacunae and provide a system for routing nutrients to osteocytes. To summarize and point out the differences between spongy and compact bone, we'll do a side-by-side comparison of the two. On the left, we have our spongy bone, and on our right, our compact bone. On our spongy bone, we have a lot of open areas where it's not really the hard bone that we usually think of. On the other side, we can see that compact bone does not have any of these open pores. The matrix of the bone is completely filled by organic substances, which provide the characteristic strength and rigidity of the bone. One last thing that we can note is that there are no haversian systems or canaliculi in spongy bone. This figure helped me to understand where each type of bone would be located, and also gave me a better grasp of the normal histology of the bone. So to sum things up about compact bone, we can remember that the matrix of the bone is completely filled by solid organic substances. The bone is also made up of multiple osteons or haversian systems. These osteons will have the presence of haversian canals and canaliculi. This concludes our review of the normal spongy bone and compact bone histology.